So tonight, we're busy with a series talking about better together. And I recognize that, just in starting off, I recognize that when we talk about partnership and about life together, companionship, about finding someone to share life together, that there are people here tonight that you've heard this before. This is not your first rodeo. And I am aware that as we discuss this, that you also wished you would have had this story. You would also wanted to be here to share your story. We will talk about companionship more in the next 2 weeks and about friendships and things like that. But tonight, I am quite confident listening to their stories. And these people have been fairly recently married. They will share a little bit of their years of experience of marriage. The point of asking people who've been married very recently is I'd like you to listen to their journeys, because their journey is like yours, and they've had disappointments and pain along the way, but their lives are symbols of hope. The stories tonight are symbols of hope. And as we just look at the slide, last week we discussed this introduction that marriage is a covenant of companionship, Vian. God said it's everything is made beautiful, except it's not good for man to be alone. He needs Christelle next to him to push the buttons. He needs a helper. Sorry, dis een van daai oomblikke nê, Vian. Ai. IT. Ken jy iemand in die IT industrie, Vian? God said everything that he made is good and is in fact very good. And then the Lord was the one who said it's not good for you to be alone. And biblically speaking, obviously there are people who are quite content, very blessed to not have someone. So you don't have to have someone if you don't want to have someone. But if there's someone, then the Lord's the first one to recognize that I see your need. It's like you're standing up and saying, the Lord's saying, I see that hand, I see that need, I will make you a helper. And tonight is a story of God making companionship. So I'm going to just first ask and start here with, I think you've been married the longest here tonight. Heinrich, Adriana, don't you want to introduce yourself, say how long you've been married now and what you like about being married?
So a total of 5 glorious months.
5 glorious months, amazing. Yeah.
And the fact that I can wake up at 4 a.m. and have someone to talk to.
4, yeah.
So my name is Marjan, and this guy is now taken. He's my husband, Neil. We got married in Jan, and for me, I must say, marriage is more than I could ever imagine. It's better than I could ever imagine in my life, and there's so much joy in it for me. I can get home after the worst day ever, and I can just be myself. And Neil will still, doesn't matter what, he will treat me as a princess always. There's joy, there's contentment, and it's amazing how the Lord uses us as a unity in marriage as well, and I really enjoy that.
How's it, folks? My name is Neil. For me, the thing that stands out is companionship. It's like really sharing, doing life with somebody in a really intimate way, sharing the ups and the downs. And like I struggle to wake up in the mornings, and she wakes up like really quickly. So this morning I still want to like snooze, and it's just wide-eyed, bushy-tailed, looking at me. She's ready for the day, and I'm still trying to wake up. Companionship stands out for me.
Yes, I think I can agree with that. Just having someone with the ups and downs and seeing everything, that vulnerable place. He's in your space now. It's vulnerable. and that is quite like it. And then also having someone to get a puppy with. And more later.
More puppies or what? More young children.
Philip, are you talking about your puppies?
Yeah. I think for me, I spent a little bit of time in community houses, like living with quite a decent amount of people, which prepared me for washing dishes and doing basic household chores. And I must say, cooking for one is easier than cooking for 16. But I think the thing that from being married, you know, for 4 months now, is that feeling of home. I think that's something I was searching for a long time, and you can search for it in various places, but there's something different about sharing, not that we do whatever, we still haven't broken that seal of certain things that you don't do around each other because you want to stay romantic, but... Actually, we have broken the seal, but we're just not going to talk about it. But, like, that's when you start to realize that you've found home. Yeah.
So, there's nog 'n lyn. There's nog 'n lyn. Okay, mooi.
You hear the sound of home. Sound of...
Okay. I'm going to ask you, and as we're sitting here, I recognize there are six people whose lives have really changed in the last 5, 4, and 3 months. And I'd like you to take us through the journey of you. Tell us a story of us. Tell us a little bit of your story. And I'd like you to take your time and just tell us two individuals, two streams flowing together into marriage. It's been a journey. And, you know, as we were talking earlier, if everything in your life was absolutely perfect, and all you had to sort out is find that one, then it would have been better, né? But now everything in life is chaos, and in between the chaos, you have to find. So tell us your story. Tell us the story of God's grace. What did the Lord do in your life, and how did you discover God in this journey?
So both Adrian and I studied at Stellenbosch. We met in first year.
Mm-hmm. In 2010.
Yeah. Well, we have different recollections of when we actually met. Hers one is a little bit different than mine, so we agreed up on 28th of February just for number's sake.
Mine is true.
So to get into the numbers, we know each other today for 3,387 days. Wow. So we were just friends for very, very long. I didn't even know, I really didn't know about anything other than our friendship for quite some time, and both Adrian and I didn't. I think I was more...
I started knowing something.
Well, yeah, and then you didn't tell me. So I don't think I'm good at relationships at all. I got hurt in my first one. I told myself, nope, not going to do that again, not going to get vulnerable again. And that's kind of where my bad streak, to be fair, I've never really been in a relationship, so I never could get to that point, so I told myself, I'm not going to do it again, not going to get hurt. So that, I think God knew he needed to prep us up with such a huge friendship gap in order to let my guard down, to figure out this is exactly who he intended for me to choose, which is pretty cool. So fast forward to 7 years worth of relationship series at church. And in 2017, Ross hosted a debunking myths about relationship. And that's where it started. I always believed that I had to be in love with someone before I could pursue a relationship with them. And that was one of the myths that was being debunked. And I thought to myself, okay, but it's okay, I understand maybe, but I don't think, not yet. And but at that point, I haven't even thought about possibly us getting in a relationship at all. In that week, there was a soup and bread and soup evening here at church. And our small group said, now we're all going to go. But lo and behold, it was a continuation of the relationship series. So this is now number 7.1. And Pietri shared, I'm not sure if he's here tonight, about his and his wife's relationship that took 10 years before it transitioned from a friendship into a relationship. And I thought, okay, maybe. And then for the first time I realized, but we're friends that long. But that's all I thought. And then in the following week, Derek and Emma shared that in small group, also their version of how their lives changed from friendship into a relationship. And I thought, okay, this is two people, three people telling me this now. Maybe I should consider it. But that also didn't happen at that point. So within 2 to 3 months, so this was May, June, July. July, I woke up the one morning and I realized, I don't think we're just friends. We've always loved each other, but I have never been in love. And then it started resonating in me that maybe this can become something. And I remember we went away. Our families are quite close, or I mean, I'm in her family, and
yeah, he's the favorite child, well, since 2010, basically. Yep.
So,
child, everything.
So it really helped not having that, or having a family without having that pressure in the family of saying, "Oh, you guys are going to get together now. What's going to happen?"
Yeah. Or now you can meet my boyfriend, or you're to meet his family. We've already known each other for like 6 years by then. Yeah.
So being under the radar really helped not having that pressure. So that was really great. And on that weekend in Azerfontein, she realized that something changed, and I did, but I didn't know how to voice it yet. So, and her version of it, I was sitting closer to her.
I was acting really strangely, and I was wondering, what's going on? Heinrich doesn't act like that. He was like cozying up to me on the couch when everyone has already gone to sleep. I was like, what?
It was winter.
But nothing happened. It was, but nothing happened, and... Yeah, just like, no, I have to go to bed now. So then, yeah, that was that. And then he left for Cape Town, and I went back to Fredendal. Yeah, and then it took another month.
Yeah, and...
Yeah, before we saw each other again.
I think at that time, one of our mutual friends also kind of told me that, by the way, she likes you. I'm not sure if I should tell you this. I'm like, oh, great. And I have to make more decisions. So... And I think it was on the Monday, he probably told me on the Saturday we had a bride, and on the Monday he told, and I messaged her, I'm like, I don't want to talk to you about this on WhatsApp, but we need to talk. And that's all I said. And was it the 20th of August, the weekend of the 20th of August?
Yeah, so I said, well, I don't want to discuss this on WhatsApp, so let's wait until we see each other again. Yeah, and that was when we went away with other friends, but they were already together. Yeah.
And I think this weekend was the first time that I realized that she knew everything of me, my good and my bad, from having this long a friendship. And knowing that I could trust her with what I always said in the beginning, like, I won't trust anyone again because I got hurt so badly, that God used the friendship to kind of break down all of those walls I had. And on that weekend, I was also like, oh, well, now I have to tell you, but I also don't want to tell you.
And I knew something was coming, so... And then later on, it was like the Saturday night, and they were leaving on the Sunday. So I was like, are you still going to talk to me? Because what's going to happen? He just said, no, it will come. Just wait.
I just want to clarify, she did corner me, and she closed the room like that, and she said, we need to talk. So I had no choice. And I told her, you know, I think I like you. I'm not sure about this. I don't know how this will change our friendship. And how, I don't know how a relationship would be. I was really honest with her. I'm like, I don't know what's going to happen. It was the most difficult thing to tell you because I didn't want to risk our friendship.
Well, neither of us knew how it was going to change, but it was...
I kissed the girl and I like it. Cherry
basically, yeah.
Okay, fine. This is the first time anyone else will hear this, so it's just between us.
But that is what happened. Yeah. Very late on Saturday night. Like Sunday morning, 1 a.m. ish. Yeah.
We were talking till that time because it was. That's all.
Yeah.
And after the talking, I said, well, once it's done, no song, ne?
Yeah.
And then I kissed her.
Oh, no.
Yeah.
And then I think from the decision of.
And then it was long distance, so we also weren't sure, like. Because I didn't have any plans to move back to Cape Town yet, and so that was also a risk factor, but it worked out.
Yeah, but I think the biggest change for me there, after I've made the decision to, okay, let's do this, for the first time I fell in love with her, so which I've never had before. And yeah, that's us. Any other questions, comments, songs?
It's in his kiss. That's what I wanted to say. It's in his kiss. Muy. Yeah, but it's great. It's really great. Similar story to me and my wife, Magret. We were friends and I kissed her and then we were not friends anymore. Okay. So. Marzal, Neil, you have two beautiful stories that came to one.
Yeah, so I got out of a 5-year relationship with my best friend for 10 years. It was a great relationship. It was awesome. The guy was awesome. We had fun. It was just amazing. But after about 3 or 4 years, I got a little bit, my spirit got a little bit disturbed. There was something missing. And I realized that there was one thing missing, and that was unity in Christ. So I got a little bit tired of going to church on my own, cell group on my own, fellowships on my own, worship evenings on my own, convergence on my own. And that was quite hard for me. And then I had decided that I had to make a decision. And as I said, it was a great relationship. But then I went and I decided to break up with this guy. So I was very heartbroken, like extremely heartbroken. But I knew that what the Lord wants for me as his daughter is the best. And one night in my brokenness, I went and I sat down in my room on my knees and I sat by the Lord and I said, Lord, what I actually want is I want someone that loves you first, and that he will one day that he will love his let he will love you first and then his wife. And then I also said, Lord, please can he a little bit be handsome as well, and also he must have like a little bit of style as well. I'm in the fashion industry for the last 12 years. Okay. But anyway, and yeah, so that was my question. That was what I asked the Lord for, and I trusted him for that. And then Neil came across.
Yeah, I think my style was to be debated, but that was all right. Some things eventually change. I was in a season where I remember driving to work the one morning, and I was listening to a Focus on the Family broadcast, and they were just speaking about really being content in your singleness, and one of the points that they raised was that if you're there's a misperception that if you're unhappy as a single, marriage is suddenly going to make you happy or content. So I made a real conscious decision to be content in my season, also knowing that God's got plans for me, and he's got awesome plans for me, and the season's going to come to an end. So anyway, so I was really living it up socially. It was massive chaos after church. We were filling out Bella Bellotta, and it was really social, and I was enjoying it. I actually knew of each other many, many years. Her maiden surname, it's changed, was Hierica. So I knew of her, but there was like zero friendship. I was actually coincidentally at her baptism, I don't know, that was like 2009 or something like that. Anyways, and then the one evening after church, guys, there's coffee after church, use it. So that was my pitch session. So I suddenly noticed this really, really stunning girl. And well, yeah, I pulled out a pitch at the back there. But yeah, I wasn't very successful initially, I'll tell you that. And anyway, so what does one do? What's step one? Like even before you ask for a phone number, you get her on Facebook. So anyway, so I added her on Facebook. And God has a sense of humor, and somehow, accidentally, I don't know, there was some bug in Mark Zuckerberg's system, but she ended up sending me, accidentally, through Facebook Messenger, like these little cute kittens blowing out candles, and it wasn't even my birthday. So I thought to myself, well, thank you, God, you really saw that one. I'm going to use this gap. So
it was really an accident. I don't know what happened with my phone that day.
So I used that as a gap to try to, well, chat her up. Closed door. So, okay. So anyway, so that pitch failed. And anyway, so eventually I plucked up the courage again. And I said to her, I'd like to take her out for dinner. I thought that was a pretty bold move. So she pulls the Christianese on and says, sorry, I'm fasting. I can't go out. So she was doing some 21-day Daniel fast of some sort.
And he really counted the days.
So I asked her, when's she finishing? And I remember it was a Monday was the last one. So she was sitting over there in the audience, and after the service I went to her, and Ross was still buzzing around there. I think that's what made it a bit awkward for Marzon. And I went over to her and I say, hey, I know your fast is finishing tomorrow. Can I take you out Tuesday evening? So anyway, so eventually, so I got my date in, and God really blessed the season. It was absolutely amazing. I asked her at end of 2016, so we weren't rushed or anything, and we really enjoyed the season. And it's really nice having somebody to share the ups and the downs and the crazy moments, like asking her to dance in a restaurant.
Where you are not allowed to dance.
And it was really, really blessed. Yeah.
Yeah, and I must say, like, during this dating, like, he really pursued me like crazy. And I was like, oh my goodness, this guy, can he just get rid of his bell-bottom jeans, his big buckles? I was like, Lord, how are we going to sort this thing out? Like, I realized that he loves Jesus first, and he is very handsome, but there was, like, I don't know about the style thing. That was, like, freaking me out. But the Lord sorted it out. I think he changed into a hipster as he sat here next to me. But, like, in our kayash, I realized that our conversations is purpose-driven. There's, like, something deeper. I started really to enjoy Neil's company. It went somewhere, and he's an adventurous guy, and yeah, so I really enjoyed that. And the one night, I remember I went, that was after a few dates with Neil. I was on my way to Bible school, and when I stopped at JJ and Jacinta's house, I text Ross. And I said to Ross, Ross, that's all I said. Do you think Neil Dupree is the coolest guy on earth? And and Ross just said, he sent me a voice note. He said, yes, I love it. And I was like, okay, because I think so too. And it was, I just enjoyed his company so much that I couldn't get enough of it.
And that was going out, and it was really, really blessed. And then middle of 2018, I plucked up the courage to ask her to marry me. And one of the other things, lots of people tell you, yeah, when you get engaged, it's a tough time, etc. And that's something that we really took ownership of, and we prayed to God, and we said, no, we're going to make this an awesome period. And it really was. God has really just blessed us. Got married end of Jan, and this is my favorite companion.
Yeah, and I just wanna quickly add what I found the Lord was telling me in my brokenness. He wants the best for his daughter. I don't have to settle for second best. So I say to him, this is what I want, Lord, if I can have it. And he gave me more than I could ever imagine. And I must say, our relationship and our marriage so far is, I can just testify of God's goodness. He is so faithful, we enjoy every moment together.
Neil, I didn't know you were such a player, bro. I've got a song for you if you want it. Bell-bottom jeans, boots with the fur. I've got looking at her. Is it my turn now? Okay. yeah, I came from let's just not hold hands right now. I just need some space.
Give each other.
Yeah, so I came from a like secular dating scene. I kind of sort of got better at dating, I guess, in high school. I really wanted to have a girlfriend from very young. Neil mentioned earlier that, like, you know, enjoy the season you're in and enjoy your singleness. And I really wasn't able to do that as a young person. I really wanted a girlfriend. And I think, like, it was one of the things that I identified as kind of like a problem with my character. So when I came to the Lord, like, it was sort of quite clear, look, there is this affinity towards women and towards females, and I was really wanting God to sort that out for me. Like, I didn't want to go through life kind of looking for the next person to kind of attach myself to, I guess. I really wanted God to deal with me so that I could be ready for what would come next. And it was a cool season, but I guess I had a bit of a defensiveness towards females, and I threw myself into ministry, which was a fantastically safe environment, But then we, yeah, I went on to a ministry training course, and Cecile was there as well, and it was like week three, and I was still adamant that like girls are, you know, for those who can't make it in Christianity, like, look, you know, you guys can go for marriage. I'm going to write the second Galatians, all right? Whoa. Yeah, anyway, so, but it's amazing how God knows us better than we know ourselves. And before I knew it, there in MTP, speaking about very spiritual things, Cecile just sort of gently started to strum my guitar. Hey, can I play your guitar?
Of, can I get your guitar spiel?
It's like, sure, just go for it. And yeah, we ended up speaking more than I anticipated speaking to a female. And I think it was just it was an awakening in a sense. I remember, was it Heinrich? No, it wasn't Heinrich. What's his name? Hercules. He was sort of like, we were intensely sharing testimonies with each other. Like, very honestly, and I remember like Heinrich sort of going like, what is going on over there? But there was really a connection quite quickly between us, and I think that was the thing. I mean, it immediately blossomed in my heart, because I'm like a bit of a puppy lover, I guess, you know? So I can't really hide if I'm in love with somebody. And then the next MTP, I kind of ended up saying to everyone, like, I've got a crush on Cecile. You know, and then she comes to visit because she wants to see Andrusha. I'm like, whatever. So, yeah. Anyway, you can maybe take over from here. Go for it. It's your turn.
Hello. Okay. I thought, yeah, just to continue from that, I think for me, where Phil tends to, like, walk with his heart on his sleeve, or he's an expresser, I can walk with something for a long time inside. But I remember I was like, ek hou van jou, ek freak my out. Ek hou van jou, ek freak jy freak my out. It was like this, what the, who are you? So I think for me, just in a nutshell, like, Phil was quite a curveball for me. I'm like a Vrystaat boerkie, it's amazing that I can speak English here tonight, type of
miracles.
Thing. Did not know, bands and stuff that Phil played. So the testimony sharing was quite funny because I told him, het jy al ooit van polisiekar gehoor? That is what I asked him in the testimony. So that was quite funny because I said, hulle het lelik gepraat. And I thought like, het ek nou dit ooit gesê? Because what I actually want to bring across was like, I was very legalistic, you know, and God had to save me from that. Like, I need grace. And then it was Easton, and he was like, okay, yeah, ken hulle ook, type thing. And it was just so refreshing. And I just remembered in that time, like, after 7 years of theology, I kan nie hierdie ou in 'n boks sit nie. Like, this is what, and you do not make sense if Jesus Christ doesn't live. Soos, jy maak nie vir my sin as Jesus Christus nie lewe nie. And that was so amazing and fascinating, yet scary, feeling like I might open up, because my picture was, you know, probably never thought of an English guy, punt een, like that I'll be, and then I joked there, and I just decided, man, gaan ons nou Afrikaans of Engels vry, and then I just decided, let's kiss in French. Joke.
Multilingual.
Can I just say something? The opinions expressed by this people does not represent the pastor or the church. It's their own. Okay.
No, jokes aside, but just from there, it was quite funny because I thought, I'm not going to think about this too much, but then we started planning summer camp together. And I think what was encouraging, we won't sort it out, each one of us. It's like, it's a journey, and sometimes I want to be sorted out, you know, before I go into something. And it was just as if our paths just kept on crossing. We both pursued, what we felt God's asking of us in that time, and we planned summer camp together, and here comes Philip in Stellenbosch door. It's like, whoa. And I remembered...
To your house. Not like the whole of Stellenbosch was like, whoa.
No.
Because that would have been good.
Yeah, but so we planned summer camp together, and then I was very, very in denial. And then they asked us, you know what, Philip and Suzelle, will you please share together on summer camp? And I says, oh, you gotta be kidding me. So it just kept on crossing. Then I went to Bloemfontein back home, and then they invited Philip to speak at the first year's camp where I was. And I was just like, okay, it is crazy.
But at the end of summer camp, they asked both of us if we'd be keen to go to America together to lead a summer camp thingy there or whatever. And like, so it was very, a lot soon. So I was like, oh my word, this is incredible.
I was like,
I just fall in love. And they're like, here's your plane tickets. You're going to America. You get a car. You get a car.
Yeah, the email said, "Dear Philip and Suzelle," yeah. It was really crazy.
Flip. Yeah.
Okay, we didn't go, and that was round one. It also didn't work out.
Yeah, our romance kind of. Yeah. So I think like I had quite a strong picture of what I saw materializing, and it was clear as day to me. But I think Suzelle was maybe keeping it deeper inside, and we each had to sort of like figure out like how was it gonna work, and yeah, eventually. After some time, and that was a difficult season. I remember being in a morning service, and like just Heinrich preached something on hope, and it was so hard to hold on to what I thought was actually just a picture. Like, you know, have I duped myself? Can I repent of this? Like, can I repent of wanting to marry this girl and being in love with her? It's very hard to repent of that. Like, sorry, she's amazing. I'm so sorry. You know, but... yeah, it was. I think it really helped me to, you know, to be a better companion to her needs as well, because, you know, she gets a little claustrophobic if people are like all up in her face. Not anymore, but back then, you know, and it prepared me for that, to allow her the space to figure out what she needed to figure out. And I think our biggest challenge to finish off, sorry Ross, is that just like that once you come face to face with each other. Is it sort of like, okay, here I am, and love is kind of happening and whatever, but it's really super scary. It was scary for me too, to, you know, in testimonies in front of people, it's easier to say like, yo, I did this, and I did this, and I did this, and Jesus saved me. But sitting across from somebody who you are potentially going to share your life with, raise a family with, you know, you are talking about your deepest character flaws, and that person has to go like, I don't know. I saw a 998 model, and they like less mileage, good service plan, still under warranty. I'm gonna maybe go, you know. So it's a tough thing to put yourself out there, but when God puts something in your heart, He gives you the courage to do that, you know. And yeah, praise God, it was safe to do so.
Yeah, I just wanna add with that scary part, and I think the authenticity, the authenticity of what Phil came across, it was like, this is where I am. And at that point where I met him, like back in 2015, it was the time where he gave everything up. It's like he didn't have a job, didn't have a car. It was just like this, so real and pure, and so what I'm not like used to at the time. And I remember I told him when I realized, oh, he's talking now eats. I was like, well, let's say. And then I started speaking English, and that didn't make sense. And he's just like, praat maar Afrikaans, and I went over like that. I remember I told him like, but don't worry, I pray for you guys. And I was very spiritual, like praying, and it's good to pray. It's good, but sometimes we hide behind the prayers. And I remember there was a time where I felt God saying, "Jy is nou klaar gevas en bid, nou moet jy opstaan." Like faith without deeds is op to it, né? And I was fasting. We were four girls, and I said, "Let's fast for our husbands. 40 days, dan weet jy, jy het nou vir hom gebid, en dan is dit nou klaar, want mens wonder nou al, you always say you must pray for your husband, pray, and I was like, I want to know that ek het hierdie gedoen, soos as hy kom, he saw my, I prayed for you, and I remember after that summer camp, I fasted sugar, and then Phil, he asked me, we were still living there on a farm, and he said, can I come and walk on the farm, and I said, I said yes, and I was like, "Flip, can you jaag?" I said, "Okay, yeah, I will." And then he came, and I didn't think about it, and I just said, like, it was just after my fast ended, actually. And I said, yes, I can't sweets yet, but I didn't think what I'm saying. And he said, oh, for what did you fast? And I was like, I can only lieg oor wat ek vas is on nie and stuff. And I just said it like, but this like 2015, I just said, you're off my man. And as soon as I said it, Philip just went like this.
You fasted sugar and God gave you sugar.
Da, 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 da.
Yeah, so it's just quite refreshing, just bringing it down to reality again, almost. Yeah, and that was quite, and just fast forwarding, I think the journey and the boldness and just the courage to say, we had hard conversations before we got married and before we started dating, and it wasn't easy always. We both went through quite a hard season last year as well. And I think the one thing that I just take from this friendship, I almost want to like get emotional now, but just is really just deciding to walk together through the ups and downs and accepting each other and the full package and growing into it. And because we also had now a thing gekry van swim in your lane, because at one time we weren't happy with each of our lines and we swam in each other's lanes, and that also didn't work. And it's as long as you go in the same direction, but don't control each other. And that was quite a journey for us as well. So just for me, it was a big thing to step out of fear and courage. And the last thing I just want to share was I didn't believe in soulmates, but I really wanted to have the guy that God prepared for me. Like, wie is die persoon wat God vir my beplan het? And I was so focused almost like that, that I missed the obvious, like, in front of me. And I remember just before we got engaged, I sat under a vineyard, and it's like the top, and I was like, Here, gee my nou net a teken. Just give me a sign. Is this my husband? I was so scared I make a wrong decision. Ek maak hom sommer glad, you know, and that's also not freedom. And I just said, just give me a sign now. And in that moment, I really felt God said, like, no, I'm not going to give you a sign. But what I did give you is a free choice. You can choose. And that was also so lucky, just knowing, ja, kies hom. And then, yeah.
Did you kiss him or did you kiss him? Can I like choose him or kiss him? Like, I really enjoy your stories, and it's very diverse, but it's amazing. It's amazing in how our stories, and I'd like you to do a similar thing in your small groups, to tell your stories and to listen to how God is ingrained into every aspect of your life. He's really concerned about it. It's amazing. The book of Ruth, we're reading that at the moment now in the church, and it's amazing that the book has only one theme, and this is a lady who wasn't even a good Jewish person at all, connected to God through a marriage, and then her husband died, and the whole story is about God had a plan for Ruth and for Boaz, and he brought them together in the weird way. A lot of initiative from her side, a lot of initiative from his side. But the story is all about God bringing these two together. It's amazing. So God really does, Isaac and Rebecca, thank you so much. And Jacob and Rachel, even Joseph and Mary, how God is ingrained in their stories. It's part of the stories. And the Bible, God is really concerned about your life, and he really is at work. And that's what I like about these stories. I just want to ask a question, and then any or all of you can just, you don't have to answer this question, but I just mentioned there in the beginning, you know, how life is so fuzzy, you know, it's like there's so many, it's not just as though everything is going well in your life, and then we only have to sort out this relational bit on the side. You know, at times it seems as though everything is chaos, and then in the middle of all this, there's this emotional turmoil as well. Did any of you identify with this in your life? With things, when there are lots of fires in your life, when there are lots of chaos in your life, when there are lots of things happening in your life, and on top of all that, you have to make relational decisions. How did you do that? You know, how did you experience that? Could you relate to that in your life?
Yeah, I think I can definitely relate with that. You know, you wish that the conditions for relationship would be perfect. You know, like it's like taking the golf shot. Like, shh, I'm just gonna play a golf shot now. Okay, shh. Like, I need to get my relationship right now. But life doesn't stop, like, in that sense, to give you those perfect moments. And I think it's probably good that way, because life doesn't stop when you're in a relationship either. You know, so you have to learn to do that together. And it's harder when you have to kind of go home every time and all sorts of logistics so that, you know, in groups and all that stuff that happens, you know. But, yeah, I think you have to kind of learn in through the fire, in a sense. I would say, like, what it granted me is to realize to create boundaries as well, to help to, you know, like, my relationship is also reserved for certain people. Like, you know, you don't just go and wear your heart on your sleeve with everyone, and that's what I tended to do as well. So it's sort of to help to keep home a portion and then not allow it to bleed into the other areas, if hopefully, yeah.
I think for me it was a lot of boldness. And you don't know what's going to happen. Maybe she says no, but there's something really lacquer about being a child of God. There's something really comforting, and there's some, I don't know, I sometimes think that us as Christians, I don't know, we reach a superhero because we've got the Holy Spirit with us. So one can really be confident and step out of that boat and not fear failure, not fear rejection. I mean, we're children of God. So, and when you really embrace that, I think it, for me, it made it a lot easier to make very bold decisions. And yeah,
for me, I'm actually very bad in making any decision. I struggle hectic with that. And I think my life was, before I got married or before I went into a relationship with Neil, it's like your mind is all over the place. Then you look for someone, then you don't. Then there's work, then there's this, then there's, so it's a bit chaotic. And then it's like when me and Neil got together, there's like, I don't want to use the word security, but there's like, it's my best friend. I want to do everything with him. It's not just me anymore. We are both making a decision of something. And there's like, it's really contentment since we've been together.
Heinrich, maybe I can ask a question to the three of you. So just to close, last question, so that you know that you still have time to bowl a few rounds at the coffee table. Grappy. So a question, but one or two of you shared in your stories that you were really badly hurt in a relationship before. And so you said you decided to be out, or to pause, or to not engage females, like Philip said the whole time, during that time. But how did you experience God in this process of re-engaging, of stepping out again, of taking courage to pursue again?
Well, I think in Adrian and I's example, God really brought us to that point to kind of not force us to re-engage, but he brought us in that way together, that we were safe enough in what we are in each other's character, in order to say, okay, well, I'm comfortable to engage because I know her character and she knows mine. And I think if it wasn't for that, it would have been much more difficult. And yeah.
So the 8-year friendship basis, it really helps in our marriage as well, because we do know each other so well and we know each other's family, so there are less surprises along the way. And every time he teases me or does something silly, he says, "Jy wou mos met jou beste vriend getrou het." So you get that side as well.
But it definitely wasn't easy at all.
Like, anyone wants to say some closing words?
I think the previous one, I think especially when you tend to go through a tough time, it's easier to go like this, like you want to find something or someone to blame for what you're going through. And I was a bit scared of marriage. So when I went through a tough time, I was like, ooh, chops, is it, is this, I was just wanting to find a solution. And then I think a cool thing, even if it was in my single season dating or in marriage, is to own your story or to own your own your yard of what's going inside here, because in the beginning we were quite like, you know, say all the lekker stuff, but then the poking starts. It's like druk mekaar se knoppies. And for us that was quite a healing journey together, because I'm quite curious about stuff, and I think Phil also had a cool testimony of that. But just in terms of self-awareness and inward searching instead of going like this was also something that I learned through tough times, to maybe just stop and reflect and go through what you need to go through type of thing for me.
I just say one last thing on the asking thing, because I also was quite badly hurt, you know, and it took something to ask somebody, and like almost the longer that you wait or out of the habit of asking somebody on a date or expressing the way that you feel about somebody, it's almost like there's this burden or this, like, it becomes a harder and harder thing. And I remember when I'd send like a WhatsApp to Susel or whatever, like I would think and pray through it so like intensely, and the more that I'd think and pray through what I'm going to say, the less mojo I would have to say what I needed to say, like, hello, hope your prayer life has been good this week. I mean, you know, coffee exists. But I think like the most embarrassing thing I did was, before you could delete voice notes, like for everyone, I sent her a couple of voice notes, and then I canceled there. I thought I was canceling then. No. And then I sent my mom's phone a voice note, and I deleted it on my side. And then I went to my mom's phone to check if it like would still play. And then my voice came out of the phone, and I was like, no! And then I said to her, like, what did you think? If I'm sending you voice, it's like, hi, Giselda. Ugh. It was like a non-issue for her. So I guess she was so worried about other stuff, like marriage, that she wasn't too phased about my voice notes. But whatever. Be an idiot. It's fine.
Yeah, you guys have it easier now that you can delete WhatsApp messages. My wife here, when she had her hair done, there's this big WhatsApp group, and if you're not on it, join it. It's like a social tool. She sent a couple selfies of a new hairstyle to the broader WhatsApp group. I think there's around about 100 people on it back then when I was on it, and it was actually intended for her best friend.
Is that when you noticed her?
I think that was I also tried pitching on that one, but that was also an unsuccessful pitch.
Like, listen, so just tonight as an encouragement, God is in these stories. There's lots of pain that happened in the past year, and God is the God that heals and restores, and then their marriages and their lives are a testimony of God's restoration. Also of dreams and desires. I mean, praying for an attractive, amazing, stylish husband, and God fulfilled all those desires. He's still busy fulfilling those desires. But the petty, God is in the details. God really is in the details of our stories. Our God is a relational God. Whenever we use the word spiritual, just substitute it for the word relational, because God is all about relationships. And it's beautiful to hear your stories. God is the one who brought you together. And the things that you have faced and you've experienced in the past, we all can identify, because all of us can identify with pains, failures, you know, shame in our own past. But God really makes all things new. So our prayer is that the journey that the Lord has started, that you'll be very blessed, that your sixth, fourth, and fourth month of marriage will even be better than the previous ones. And it's our heart's desire to, if any of you are in need, you know, we've been dinged up in relationships in the past. And we are digging one another up in relationships as we speak also. Just want to say that we'd love to pray with you. If any of you have a need, you know, just to pray with us, we'd love to do that. But look at these people. You're welcome to keep your eyes open when I pray now. But look at them as a sign of hope, you know, what the Lord has done for you. God is not a respecter. God is not a respecter of persons. God doesn't treat one person the same way, not the other one. Our God is a God of justice. And I just want you to take note of what they said. 8 years,
6 years, years. These are stories that didn't just culminate in a moment, but it does change in a day. It's a story that comes a long way, but it changes in a day. God can do the same for you. God can do the same for you. Father, we thank you for these people, God, these men and women, God, that their lives witness that you are part of every aspect, every disappointment, every joy, every hope, every dream, every failure, every mistake, God, and every conflict. I thank you, God, that in all things we are more than overcomers because Christ is part of our story. And tonight we heard a few times, God, that you are the God of comfort, the God who comforts us, that walks with us. We are never, ever alone because you walk with us. Thank you, Lord, for preparing our future. Thank you for the good plans that you indeed have prepared for us. Thank you for the stories of the Bible, God, that witness, God, that you bring people together for your purpose, for your glory, that they may have joy and that your kingdom may come through their lives. So thank you, Lord, for Philip and Susel. Thank you for Neil Marzon. Thank you for Adriana and Heinrich. Thank you for their testimonies tonight of your faithfulness. And I thank you, God, that we can expect the same goodness from the same good God who is in control of everything. Thank you that even now you're weaving our paths together. In Jesus' name, amen.